They will be doing a few, well, I think primarily my exercise, so I'll need your creativity. I'll need your input for sure. We'll also be discussing things that are a little more depth. We're going to be using some data that Lori has shared with us that I understand you all have already seen. And then we're going to get to the work of your obligations. Before we begin, though, does anyone have any questions that have been percolating since last week? Or any comments that they'd like to share since we have time?
We should be clear about the nature of the joke here, because perhaps you didn't see the title of last week's presentation, which was our obligation because Lori made us do it. And so now we're shifting the focus from the stuff we talked about last time to a more practical application of what you can do in the classroom. That was fun.
All right, so mental note for next time. We'll just take care of it. So, I promise the text is not this small on all the other slides. We're going to do a little bit of a review, talk about race, when does race matter, diversities, and future actions. The future actions will be work that you will do. So let's go ahead and get started then. Homework from last week. How or when does race matter in your school? And I think at the end of last week's presentation, we also added another question. How or when does race matter in your own lives?
In a global sense, it could be just the idea popped up in your head at some point.
Go ahead.
It just happened to come up with my students were taking the climate survey that we have to do how students are feeling. And one of the questions has to do with them identifying their ethnicity or race. And I had multiple students ask, I don't know what this means, and I have all the choices and things like that. And okay, now I have the decision of either telling you what you think or, categorizing them myself, which I also didn't want to do either. So I said, you decide what works best for you, and if you are sure that you can put on something like this.
What age students were you working with?
4 years.
So they're about nine and ten.
So I have quite a few that didn't know which one would resonate. I said, if any of them look familiar to you, on that, otherwise
you can click other, but I didn't want to categorize them if
that's not how
okay.
I identify either.
So here's the awful question that I asked. What races were those students who were saying they don't know what they are? Generally, again, fully recognizing that in answer to the question, you're not categorizing them for what
they So I would say the majority were white, or it wasn't my African American students. They were able to identify that, or it was some other thing that was such a mass grouping, Pacific Islander. But it wasn't my African American students.
Sure. Okay. Thank you. Mm-hmm. What else have you been thinking about race for the past week? Yes, please.
I had a few kids that asked me, "Why does that matter? Why does that matter in the survey?"
Could you tell us a little bit more about the nature of the survey? What exactly it was?
Well, Lori.
it's the climate survey that the district gives out, and they collect all sorts of data from students. Parents did it. Hopefully, you did it, because I didn't. So as a parent, one of us should have, and then staff do it as well.
Yes, go ahead.
I had to fill out a form for something, and you can only choose one. And so I'm thinking about how many millions of people, why would you pick one?
Isn't that true? How other is a box of
people?
Other
African American and Caucasian. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. What in general are we told? Told versus taught. What are we told to pick, and what are we taught to pick? It's more of a biracial or multiracial. Are folks told?
I can't speak in that situation, but if I had a biracial child, I would walk into
I think it depends on the situation too. I have some cousins that are Mexican and white, and they kept being told by different scholarships and things like that to identify their Mexican heritage rather than their Danish heritage, because it would get them more financial aid. But then in other situations, they were told to, you know, more focus on the whiteness because it would put them more in the majority.
Yes, always.
I had biracial twins a number of years back at the old Kennedy. And the dad was African-American and the mom was white. And one twin always drew herself as white and the other twin always drew herself as black. That's cute. Just amazing.
Other comments about or other answers to this question? What have you been thinking about race for the past week?
We had a conversation today about the immigration. We got some other students in our room. We were reading a book, and it came up, and we just had to stop and talk about it because, you know, it's like they're not being responsible. You know, the one little girl was worried, and I didn't know she hadn't said anything. But, and we had a conversation at lunch today, too, about it a little bit of, you know, how uncomfortable they might feel or you even know how they feel because they don't say anything to us. And so I just asked today, and it came up with a book, and she's really uncomfortable. It's like, so then we just said, you're safe here. You know what I mean? If you're safe, and we can talk about it if you need to. So, but it's not fun.
Yeah.
I had a first grader afraid that if Trump was elected, that she was going to be some sort of she's first grader. And it's hard to answer that question because I couldn't guarantee her that she wouldn't. I said, I don't know. I would do anything in my house. She says, I don't know how to feel. I don't know.
This is an uncomfortable conversation, isn't it? Especially as one of the folks that I can tell I'm one of the minorities, there may be other minorities here. But think about the context in which you're operating, like we talked about last week. Talking about race is difficult nationally. Talking about it in the context in which Kennedy finds herself now, having been, let me rephrase that, having been around for a while, having had different demographics from years gone by to the current demographics, recognizing that some of you were here when Kennedy was what it was, and are here now, obviously, seeing the changes with your students, but also perhaps seeing the changes with your interactions with your colleagues, even how you talk about issues with students. So, honesty check, how many of you didn't really think about race at all this past week? I appreciate your honesty.
Would you ask that question again, please?
Yes, how many of you did not think about race this past week?
All of you did, then, what you're suggesting.
Okay. This wasn't for our own gratification. Yeah, are you thinking about us all? No. As awesome as we are, I don't think we're ready to be about us. So here's that question today. It's like the different. If you haven't thought about race today, within the past week since we've been here, what does that tell you? And if that is our reality, as we continue on our conversation with you for a little bit, I'd like to think about that, because we're going to see that showing up in a little bit. Go ahead.
There's kind of a tension in there, too. There's kind of a tension in there between talking about race of your own volition, because it's something that you're curious about and you're thinking about, or something that you are actively processing, and talking about it because of an issue in the class or because of something you saw in the news. I'm not suggesting that one's preferable than the other, but I think that if we think about the question that way, how many of you just sort of mused about race or were forced to think about race because of your activities outside of the classroom or outside of the school? The answer to that question might be a little bit different. And so that's one of the things that we want to bring up as part of our review, is thinking about the effects of race and how disproportionate they can be. So, these guys, we want to talk a little bit about the effects of racial difference. Do you guys remember last time? I think we talked about W.E.B. Du Bois. We did, didn't we? Did we do that collectively, or is that just in this region? Because I remember talking about it earlier. We did it collectively. Did we talk about the Valentine's Day experience?
No. About the boy, or the girl.
Could you tell a story for us all?
Oh, you said that the girl didn't want to accept the boy's Valentine because he didn't realize that he was lacking clothes. First she gave him the Valentine.
That was awesome. Say that again with confidence.
Okay. The black boy gave the other girl a Valentine, and she didn't accept it because of his race, and he wasn't aware of his race until she pointed it out.
That was much more confident, wasn't it? More certain. Yeah, hold on. So, because actually, in a sense, I hadn't thought about this before, but that's kind of one of the things we're doing, is we're trying not just to learn more about race, but to gain confidence in talking about it. Sensitivity and confidence at the same time. So what you just suggested was a story from The Souls of Black Folk that W.E.B. Du Bois tells in his book. This book really tells when he's trying to introduce his own acknowledgement of the existence of race. And he says that when he was young, he was just a dude. He's light-skinned, he's growing up in Massachusetts in the middle of the 19th century, and for him, life was not about race. Until that moment in an elementary school context, when he tried to give a girl a Valentine, and she said, no, I don't want it because you're black. That was, we talked about that last time, because it was a way of thinking about time before race and time after race, to think about race as an active thing, as a verb, as something that happens, not something that just is. Does that make sense? And how we talked about it last time? We wanted to talk, because if there's a time before you're conscious of it, and then you are, then something has been done, something has happened, something has changed. It's a verb, not a noun. So we talked about that particular episode as a way of thinking about the verb as a noun. Now imagine yourself in elementary school. It's probably not harder for you all, actually. So, but imagine yourself in elementary school. For me, at least, before everyone got a Valentine. Most of you were that way, right? We lived in a world before Valentines were mandatory for everybody. Mm-hmm. No? So, all right. My people. But you're old enough to remember that moment. That was a stressful moment when you didn't know how many Valentines you were going to get. That was traumatic. That was tense. So when Du Bois is told no because of the Valentines, do you think that's just acknowledge, oh, hey, I'm black, that's cool, I'm good? Or do you think something else traveled with that acknowledgement? What do you think traveled with that acknowledgement? His awareness of race was not just aware that he was black or that he was of African descent. What else happened with that?
But he was rejected because of it.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Could you unpack that a little bit?
He was rejected because he was black.
Right.
So I can't be friends with you, or I can't accept you.
Not because he was a person,
right,
but because he was a category.
Right.
Later in the story, Du Bois says that this is the moment when he realized he was a problem. He was no longer a person, he was a problem. And that was the moment of his realization. The realization of his racial consciousness was also a realization not just of inferiority, but of a certain kind of attention that he would receive for the rest of his life. We think about that as one of the consequences of racism or of racial thinking, which is why it's so awesome when you're talking about how you have students who are trying to fill out boxes on form, and they don't know what to fill out, and you did not tell them what to put. That is fantastic. That is brilliant. Because what would have happened if you had? You're categorizing them. You're doing kind of what Du Bois is talking about. Does that make sense? Now, one of the effects of this is something that Du Bois calls double consciousness. He kind of takes the idea, and the idea goes way, way back. Have you guys heard about that before, the phrase double consciousness? Are you familiar with it at all? Can I get hands instead? You can put yours down. I was Lori. That's the mean to that lady.
He points you all even. I mean, you see all our training. Okay, so what category are you in now? Shame on you.
Before this started. It kind of gets the idea from Emerson, but you're going to see that it's actually got a much longer intellectual history. Like, you're like, oh, that sounds kind of like Plato. Yeah, it does kind of a little bit too. But he starts by talking about, Emerson's talking about how we are torn in half. Every human being has a kind of spiritual nature and kind of a monkey nature at the same time. Right, we have ambitions for the greater, the transcendental, and for hope, and for being beyond our bodies, and then our bodies, our lizard brain, I think it's talked about now, has a sort of natural pragmatic considerations. And sometimes what you want and what you are not the same thing. The nature of double consciousness is that they can never be the same, and they were always in tension. It's not that one is good and one is bad. It's that you're always both at the same time, and that makes us all just a wee bit schizophrenic. Does that make sense? Like, everyone is just part of our psychologies. We're torn between at least two things at all times. And rather than preferring one or the other, we are a product of the tensions between the two. Between what you want and what you are. Always torn between those two things. Between what is natural and what is spiritual. They're always kind of a combination of those two things in active, productive tension. Du Bois takes that concept and he extends it a little bit. And says that to be raised is to both be yourself and what other people think you are at the same time. I think I'm just a person, but now I'm a box. Clearly that happens to anyone who fills out a census form. But when we're talking about it in the context of race, it's much deeper because you're not just a box, you're a problem. You're both a problem and the person who's supposed to solve it. You're both yourself and you're how other people view you. You're your own understanding of blackness or whiteness or whatever and others' eyes internally upon you. Now, this is there's a horrible academic essay, I absolutely despise it, that talks about this concept applied to teenagers. Because teenagers are crazy. Because they are always viewing themselves through their own eyes and someone else's eyes at the same time. I remember, and maybe some of you have better stories than this, but when I remember my first day of high school being so terrified. On that first day. Anyone else, you start a new school, especially at high school, your very first day? That's not a normal fear, that's a deep existential terror. I was so freaked out that I was certain everyone was going to be staring at me every minute if I brought a backpack or if I didn't. At about a mile and a half walk to high school, I turned back and walked the other direction at least 7 times because I wasn't sure if I was supposed to have a backpack or not because everyone was going to be staring at me at all times. Can you imagine that kind of mindset? Maybe some of you were better, were more sane at that age. But nonetheless, you can think when you pick out an outfit and you go somewhere, oh, everyone's looking at me. That's something that we think about a lot. And I read this academic article once that said that was teenagers, and teenagers had double consciousness. That's just wrong and silly, because being a teenager ends. Being a teenager ends. It's not a box that you check that stays with you forever. It's a big difference. Conceptually, it helps us think a little bit about what Du Bois is talking about, is the effects of race. If we think about that kind of being of two minds at the same time, being yourself and how other people view you at the same time, but that's not good enough, because being a teenager ends, and you are aware of yourself, perhaps in some ways is a problem, but not forever. Does this make sense? So double consciousness. You're both yourself, and you have something else views you. So, in this sense, when we think about we were just talking about the Valentine's Day event. That's a traumatic experience for young Du Bois. Traumatic in the psychological sense, the way we think about it now. That did damage to him at that point. One of the things that filtered out from our conversations when we talked about the first time you had a race is that overwhelmingly, at least with the folks that I listen to, and I'm gonna guess it's true for the rest of you as well, a lot of those moments were situated within institutions, specifically schools and the like, places where you have to fill out forms like that. When you talked about acknowledging race for the first time in your life or being aware of it, more often than not, it had something to do with an institution, with some sort of faceless machine that was stamping you one way or the other, or you were in a place where because you were in a school, you were forced to sit next to people who didn't look like you. Those are often those kinds of moments. And what we're looking at today is the role of institutions, specifically public schools, perpetuating what kind of influence they have on the experiences of race that your students have. Does that make sense? So this is a visual that many of you have probably seen before. You've probably seen the first two, but not the third one. The first one has, for those in the back who can't see it very well, the first has three people standing on one box each in front of a fence, trying to look at a baseball game. In the first image, it is assumed that everyone will benefit from the same supports, one box. They are being treated equally. The second visual, you've probably seen this as well. The taller person doesn't need any boxes. The middle person needs one, and the shorter person needs two. In the second image, individuals are given different supports to make it possible for them to have equal access to the game. They are being treated equitably, right? And then finally, in the third picture, which doesn't come out too often, is the third image, all three can see the game without any supports or accommodations because the cause of the inequity, this wooden fence, was addressed. The systemic barrier has been removed. I'm going to ask you all to do that. If you were to come up with a metaphor to describe the relationship between equality and equity at Kennedy, what would it be? I'd like for you to work in your small groups at your tables for a few minutes. I'd like for you to be creative. And I'd like to suggest that after you all have done this, we vote on which new metaphor for equality and equity will be the equity logo for Kennedy for the academic year 2017-2018. You may not use equality is everyone has shoes. Equity is everyone has shoes that fit. I've taken that one away from you. Sorry. I want you to think about this exercise specifically related to this place. What makes sense in regards to equality and what makes sense in regards to equity? So go ahead, spend some time writing some ideas down, like brainstorming.